Berks Inter-Cultural Alliance on BCTV is supported by Berks Inter-Cultural Alliance.
Good evening, Reading in Berks County, and welcome to the Berks Inter-Cultural Alliance show for May 2018. My name is John Morgan, I'm your host. And tonight, my special guest is Stacey Taylor. And Stacey is president of the Reading Branch NAACP. She's doing a marvelous job.
Thank you.
With the NAACP. Our topic tonight's gonna be Juneteenth. And we'll talk about what that is in a second. I want to take a brief just moment to remember our veterans. Yesterday was Memorial Day, which is why we're on tonight instead of last night. You know, we need to remember our veterans, those who fought and died for this country. Robert Jefferson and I have been doing a series of shows about the African Americans who fought in all our wars and stuff. We need to remember all of our veterans, everyone who served, white, black, brown, Indian, Asian, whatever. Everyone served equally, died equally. So, we'll move on to our topic, which is Juneteenth.
Okay.
Stacey, what is Juneteenth?
Well, Juneteenth is the celebration of freedom. Texas was the last state in the Union to have found out that the slaves were emancipated through the Emancipation Proclamation written by Lincoln. That was 2 years after the writing of the document. So because Texas was the last state in the Union to find out, which was on June the 19th, that's the date that we actually celebrate the holiday, that is a day of freedom where people are free to express themselves, to celebrate that they were no longer slaves. They could be free to just go about their everyday normal lives without being bound to a particular person or considered as chattel, as property. So it's a way of them getting together and, you know, having church celebrations, having parades, enjoying good food. Usually when in the African American community or the black community, when we celebrate things, it's always centered around church because that has been what has been able to sustain our community throughout the history of slavery.
Right.
So the Juneteenth is celebrated amongst 43 of the 50 states in the Union. It became a legal holiday in the state of Pennsylvania in 2011. And so—
Pretty recent.
Pretty recent, yes. This is not something that's new to our community. There have been other organizations, ACOR, which was organized by Ed Terrell, along with CPAM, Central Pennsylvania African American Museum. They were just a few of the organizations that I'm familiar with who helped to celebrate the holiday in our community.
It's an important holiday. And we have to remember that back in the 1860s, there was no instant communication. There was no social media. There were
wasn't.
It took 2 years for the news of the Emancipation Proclamation to reach Texas.
That's what they say. There's been a number of stories behind that. Some say that it was because of the fact that they were taking in some, you know, harvesting some crops and things, that was the reason why they held off in spreading the word in Texas. Some people just say, like you said, because of the way of, you know, the news traveling, the word didn't get down there in time. And then with the war going on, they didn't have enough of the northern troops to, you know, overtake the troops in the South to be able to enforce. And
it took till then for the Union to occupy Texas.
Right. So,
because the Emancipation Proclamation didn't just automatically free all slaves.
No, it didn't.
It was really a strategic ploy by President Lincoln to deprive the Confederacy of its valuable resource in the slaves.
Right.
And we have to remember there were millions of slaves at that point in the South. And by freeing all the slaves in the states in rebellion, which is what the Emancipation Proclamation did. It crippled what was left of the Confederacy at that point of the war. So, you know, there were still slaves in some border states, mm-hmm. like Delaware, Maryland, Kentucky, Tennessee, and Missouri and stuff. So it wasn't until after the war, actually, that everyone was freed.
Right.
But Juneteenth celebrates when they were, the freedom for the slaves was announced in Houston, Texas. There were, 250,000 slaves?
Yes.
In Texas at the time?
At that time, yes.
A lot of people.
Yes, a lot of people. And to not be aware of having their freedom, I couldn't imagine. But yes,
yeah,
it's a lot of people.
Imagine, you know, it's hard to imagine being somebody's property, but then, you know, you were technically legally freed and you don't find out about it for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
That had to be frustrating.
Right. And even finding out then that you were free, you still weren't really free because you didn't know what that was. They didn't know what that was or what that would actually entail at that particular time. What did it mean to be freed? Free to do what? Because I was always told what to do, you know, when I could get up, when I could go to bed, who I could marry, if I could have my children.
Yeah.
So.
And where they were going to live.
Right.
At that point, they didn't have home anymore.
No, they didn't. One day you're free and then not know where you're going to lay your head and, you know, have a roof over your head.
Right, or your next meal.
Right.
So the community here in Berks County is going to do a big Juneteenth celebration. So
yes.
Let's talk about what's going to happen here.
Okay. Well, this year what we've done is we've reached out to the organizations, churches, businesses, and social organizations in the community of African American descent and asked if they would like to participate in putting together this weekend celebration. As I said in the past, I've known that they've had celebrations, but I'm unfamiliar with them having anything more than one day. So a huge undertaking, but I'm very excited about it because we have so many people that have come on board and want to be a part of this. It's going to start Friday, June the 15th at 6 p.m. with church services at Bethel AME. Bethel AME being the oldest African Methodist Episcopal Church in the city.
And one of the oldest African American churches.
Yes, one of the oldest.
In the county.
Yes. We'll be hosting the event that Friday night. Like I said, it'll be church services. We'll also be recognizing local unsung heroes from the community, people who have given back in various ways through their charity work and or just through generous donations that they've given to organizations to help, you know, the youth in the community and or their particular social organization. So that'll be Friday evening.
Okay. And starting at 6 p.m.
At 6 p.m. Then Saturday, June the 16th mm-hmm. at 7 a.m. we'll start with registration. The NAACP will be hosting its first 5K run walk event, which is called We Live in Unity.
Mm-hmm.
That is a project where we've started walking clubs in the community. We started last August. Because the NAACP is about fighting discrimination, we were hoping that we would use the walking clubs as a means for people to get out, mm-hmm. introduce themselves to their neighbors, and just go for a walk. One of the tenets of the NAACP is a health component, and mm-hmm. with doing so, we were hoping to, you know, get people to meet their neighbors, establish some type of relationship, but then also help with freeing themselves up from health issues, diabetes, obesity, what have you.
High blood pressure, everything.
High blood pressure, yes. So that will be that Saturday morning. The race starts at 8. And then Saturday afternoon from 12 to 6, we'll be moving over to the lawns at the Berks Lodge, number 47, 237 Walnut. We'll be there and we'll be having a family barbecue, which is free to the community. People will be able to come and, you know, get some food, enjoy some of the activities that will be held that day, held during that event. We're expecting the Reading Library to come to offer some information regarding genealogy, because that's so important for our community, because you know, having been slaves and not really knowing family members,
so much of that knowledge was lost.
Right. So this way, it'll give them some ideas. And they can go to the library and utilize the resources that are available there to do some research and, you know, find some family members they haven't been in contact with and or that they're, you know, newly discovered.
Right.
So, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Get back to the 5K walk for a second. Mm-hmm. Where do people go to participate?
The 5K run walk will be held on the corner of the Yoakum Library. It'll be in the River Road area.
At RAC.
At RAC, that is correct. I'm sorry, I didn't say that. But yes, we'll be down there, and we're going to across the Schuylkill River, go out to Toon Trail a little bit, and then return back to the area at the Yoakum Library.
Okay, yes. All right. The family barbecue, that's from noon to 6 p.m., that sounds like it's going to be a lot of fun.
I'm hoping so. We're planning a lot of different activities. We have some things for the kids. Face painting, some games, and the same for the adults. We're also going to be recognizing some of the local DJs from the community that have, you know, had a profound effect upon the African American community. So we'll be recognizing some of those gentlemen, and then maybe having a battle of the DJs. I don't know, between the young and the old. We'll see. But so there'll be musical entertainment. Some of the churches will be there, and they'll be bringing some of their choirs. Some of the colleges, the local colleges, they'll be there, RAC, Alvernia, Albright, and then the hospital, Reading Hospital will be there, Penn State will be there as well. So we have quite a few individuals that will be there sharing, you know, resources, good materials for the community.
And this is at the Berks Elks Lodge.
Berks Elks Lodge, that is correct.
Which is where?
237 Walnut Street, between 2nd and 3rd.
All right. Okay. All right. So right downtown, easy walking distance.
That is correct. Easy access. Also, during the family barbecue, we're hoping to have tours to take people to the CPAM.
Okay, Central Pennsylvania African American Museum.
Right. They'll be open from 2 to 4.
Okay.
And then also, if anyone is interested, they'll be able to go to the Goggle Works and, you know, see what's available.
That's right there.
Right there across in the parking lot. So, yes.
Where can people park to attend this?
It'll be along the street. Okay. So there's not a specific designated area, so anywhere along the street they'll be able to park.
Okay, okay. Mm-hmm. There are going to be activities for kids there?
Yes, we'll have a kids zone. Kids will be able to play games. We'll have face painting. So there'll be some good things.
Sounds like a fun time.
I believe so.
So that's going to be, so basically there's stuff all day Saturday.
Yes, all day Saturday.
Okay. Then on Sunday, what's?
Then on Sunday, June the 17th, which is Father's Day, we will of course be celebrating Father's Day, but we'll wrap up the weekend celebration with church services at Zion Baptist Church.
Okay.
Zion being the other oldest Baptist church in the community. So we'll be there, and that'll be at 10:45.
And that's on Washington Street.
That's, yes, 2nd and Washington.
2nd and Washington, right by the Berks County Community Foundation there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, okay. And you're looking, still looking for volunteers?
Yes. We believe that we will need volunteers to help with, you know, serving, some of the resource tables, you know, helping with the children's activities and things, and just kind of like making sure we have a smooth flow with the traffic of individuals coming in, making sure everyone's, you know, attended to and they're able to get something to eat and, you know, finding a seat and enjoying themselves.
Good, good. So if you're interested in volunteering, how do you,
they should contact the Reading NAACP at 1-800-262 5148.
All right. And if they want to get information online, is that available?
No, we don't have anything online. Right. There's the announcement of Juneteenth on the NAACP website, but there's nothing specifically dedicated to Juneteenth.
All right. Well, that sounds like it's going to be a big deal. And it is.
Yes, it will be.
Historically, it's a big deal.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I think it's a good opportunity for people to come and, you know, learn a little bit about what Juneteenth is all about, but also just, like I said, have a relationship with your neighbors. We don't have those opportunities that often. They're so few and far in between. It's a chance to relax and, but also get some good information about what's available in our city as far as our youth is concerned. And then, you know, just as far as our hospitals and things, some of the things that they're mm-hmm. offering the services in.
Yeah, and with the colleges participating too, it's going to be good. While I have you here, we've kind of covered this pretty well. There have been some recent events affecting the African American community, including today with Roseanne Barr.
Okay.
I'd call her vile racist, but I don't want to be redundant. But she released a tweet this morning calling Valerie Jarrett, who was a senior White House advisor to former President Barack Obama, an ape.
Right.
And because of that, ABC Disney canceled her show. Her agency dropped her. And several networks have stopped running reruns of her original show. But this is just the latest kind of racist eruption. And how is this affecting the community?
Well, I think it starts with the person sitting in the White House. I think because of his behavior, the behavior that he's demonstrated as the leader of the country, he's almost, not almost, he has empowered, he's made people feel as though they're entitled, they've been emboldened to be able to say and do whatever it is they think they, you know, should be able to say. And unfortunately, that is not the case. These are not new things. They're just said aloud now. They were whispers before. They're said behind closed doors. So I think that what happened with her, and I'm not familiar with all of that, as I said in our conversation, I believe ABC did the right thing to address it right away. I think some of the things that she said when she first came back on air, maybe back then they should have done something. But I guess they gave her a chance. And so
gave her enough rope to hang herself.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. And that's exactly what she did, so.
Yeah. But there have been so many other incidents lately. The lady out in Oakland in the park calling the police on the men who were barbecuing in the park.
Yes.
And she's just become a disgraced meme on social media.
Yes.
I bet I've seen 40 or 50 different memes were at that.
I think we all have. And it's a shame. In a way, I kind of feel bad for her because
I don't think.
Well, I feel bad for her in the sense that, now she's been put on blast the same way she put those gentlemen on blast by standing there. But because of the fact that I don't think her intentions were to be malicious to this degree, but it's unfortunate that, you know, she felt the way that she did, and instead of just making her phone call and walking away for her to stand there as long as she did, it's sad, but like you said, she shouldn't have done what she did. I don't think it was her right or her place, but then you have to question law enforcement.
Yes.
I get when people call, they have to come out, but when they come out, I think that because people feel empowered, that they, to themselves, feel as though, you know, the call that was made, there's some justification in it. So therefore, they feed right along into it, and it's just...
But maybe shouldn't they be fined for wasting the police department's
time? I think that they should. I think that if you call the police and the police come out and evaluate the situation and determine that, you know, no one's been harmed, no laws have been broken, then I think you should. It's just like, you know, parking your vehicle or jaywalking. You should get a fine or, you know, some type of charge for that. But then again, when the police come out, as in the case with the gentleman at the Starbucks restaurant, I'm sorry, but you're supposed to come there to assess the situation, not just automatically assume. And I think until we get a handle on how things are supposed to be handled by the police, that I think we'll continue to see things like this happen. And I think it starts with law enforcement. They've had their training to de-escalate, the unbiased, implicit, what have you. You can have all the training in the world, but until you start putting that training into action, until you start handling situations better than what you're doing, I don't see where things will change. But I think it starts with them.
Well, and today Starbucks actually shut down all the corporate-owned coffee shops for training.
That is correct.
So that's a step in the right direction. But what can the more do you think the community can do to combat racism, say?
Continue to have dialogue sessions to talk about it. I think that we have to be able to sit down, have a conversation, be open and honest about things, but be respectful of one another. I don't understand, and I think it's in those conversations that we could get people to explain or tell why they feel the way that they do. Why do you feel threatened by an African American person when you initially meet them or when you come in contact with them? Because if nothing has been done to you, why do you feel like, you know, there's going to be some harm or danger to being will be done to you?
I think one of the most important things to do is to build interaction, get to know people.
You have to.
And you know, both of our organizations are kind of dedicated to tolerance, racial cooperation, everything. And it's just such a monumental task to take on.
It is.
It's country. And it's so frustrating to get to a point like this in 2018 where we're still seeing things like this happening constantly.
Yeah. It's like the Band-Aid's been ripped off.
Yes. Yeah. And the gaping wound of racism is open for everyone to see, which might be a good thing if we learn to deal with it some way.
Right.
But I'm afraid we won't. We haven't yet.
Well, we'll have to pray about it and hope that something will be done within our lifetime. I would have never thought that we would have seen an African-American person in the White House. So anything is possible. I'm of the belief that things can change, but people have to be willing to change.
Yes.
And I think until we can, you know, start to change laws, the way people, the way we view one another, I think that we'll just continue down this path.
But we need more open minds.
We do. We do.
Maybe Juneteenth celebration, you know, it's an African-American community event. But I'm sure if a white viewer out there wants to
It's an African-American holiday, yes, because we do celebrate 4th of July, but the United States wasn't free at that particular time. And this African Americans were still in bondage in slavery. So, this particular event, we're hoping that everyone will come out
and
celebrate freedom for the community, freedom from health issues, just freedom from being just oppressed and suppressed.
And it's a good Saturday afternoon to come out and just enjoy the barbecue, the good times,
laughter,
the fellowship.
Yes, and just get to know one another. So hopefully we'll be able to do that day.
And
That entire weekend, I should say, because it's a weekend.
And Juneteenth is a really, really important celebration.
Yes, it is.
Commemorates a very important day.
Yes, it does. And it's sad that it took 2 years after the fact, but better late than never.
Yes, yes. But, in the 1860s, there just weren't a whole lot of ways to get the word out. And of course, you know, I'm sure that the slave owners in Texas weren't going to reveal
wouldn't. No, they weren't, if they could hold on just a little while longer. If I could, I'd like to share with you why we celebrate Juneteenth. Juneteenth. J stands for Juneteenth, represents the joy of freedom, the chance for a new beginning. The U is unless we expose the truth about the African-American slave experience, Americans won't truly be free. The N, never must we forget our ancestors' endurance of one of the worst slave experiences in human history. E, every American has benefited from the wealth blacks created through over 200 years of free labor, and Juneteenth allows us to acknowledge that debt. T, to encourage every former slaveholding state to follow Texas and Oklahoma's example and make Juneteenth a state holiday. E, every day in America, blacks are reminded of the legacy of slavery. Juneteenth counters that by reminding us of the promise of deliverance. E, even on the journey to discover who we are, Juneteenth allows us to reflect on who we've been, allows us to reflect on where we've been, where we are at, and where we're going as a people. And never give up hope is the legacy our enslaved ancestors left. It is this legacy that produced black heroism in civil war and helped launch the modern civil rights era. It is the legacy we celebrate. T, to proclaim all the world to hear that human rights must never again become subservient to property rights. And H is history books have only told a small part of the story. Juneteenth gives us a chance to set the record straight. Freedom is always worth celebrating.
Yes. And Stacey Taylor, I thank you for being my guest tonight. And with that, we'll sign off and we will see you next month. Thank you for tuning in.
Berks Intercultural Alliance on BCTV is supported by Berks Intercultural Alliance.